Safari is the iPhone's default browser, and it's jam-packed with features and tools that most people don't know the first thing about. Would you like to learn? Stick around, I got you covered. I'm Dylan Stewart, the Mac Whisperer, and in this video, we're going to take a deep dive into how to use Safari on the iPhone. Stay tuned for my MacWhisperer power tip because this is going to make it simple for you to get to that website you're hunting for in one click. Let's hop on over to the phone and get started. Our first lesson is all about the address bar. The address bar sits down at the bottom of Safari, but it wasn't always down at the bottom. Up until a couple of years ago, it was up at the top of Safari like it is on the iPad and on your computer. But they moved it down to the bottom for a very specific reason and, of course, didn't tell anyone. So people who are averse to change went into settings and put it back up to the top. If you're one of those people, I recommend leaving it down at the bottom and I'm going to tell you why. Because unlike your iPad and your computer, we use our phone from the palm of our hand. And when we're holding into the palm of our hand, our thumb is usually down at the bottom. Which means when the address bar was up at the top, you were constantly having to use two hands to change to a new website or adjust your grip in order to click all the way up the top of the phone. By moving the address bar down to the bottom, it makes it so much easier and so much more functional to use. But why would you want to click on the address bar in the first place? Well, there's tons of reasons why, but most notably, the address bar has two main functions. First off, you can click on it to go to any website by typing in the address, just like this. Clicking right on the bar here, if I type in a website that I know, like Amazon, it'll automatically suggest Amazon at the top, and simply by clicking go, it will take me to that web page. But that's not the only thing that you can do with the address bar. It can also be used as a search bar. If I click on it again, I can search for anything that I need to find on the internet, even if I don't know what the website is. I can even use the little microphone in order to dictate it just like this. Fun things to do in Los Angeles this weekend. And it will perform that search with your default search engine. You can always change your search engine by swiping out of Safari, clicking on Settings here, and scrolling down to the bottom to the Apps section. From here, you can use the letters on the right side to jump to the S's and right into Safari. Right here, we'll see our search engine options. You can choose between Google, Yahoo, Bing, DuckDuckGo, which is an awesome search engine that prioritizes your privacy, and Ecosia, which is a nonprofit ecological search engine that promises to plant trees for every search that you do. Once you've selected your preferred search engine, we can come out of Settings and back into Safari. Now, any search that you do from your address bar will go through that search engine, making sure that you can find whatever website or whatever search you want to perform easily. But that's not the only thing that the address bar can do. The address bar hides a ton of really valuable tools. By clicking on this little icon on the left side when you're on a website, you can enable what's called reader mode. Reader mode takes articles and makes it easier to read them without all the ads and images and other distracting features. If we look at this particular website, we can see there are ads all over the place and things that have nothing to do with the article. But as soon as I click on that icon and enable the reader mode, it clears all of that junk out of the way and leaves me with just the article that I want to read. In addition to that, if I click on the reader icon on the left side here, I can change the color of the website from white to sepia tone to gray and even to black. I can change the font from any of these fonts that I like to use to make it even easier to read, and I can increase or decrease the size of the text by clicking on the little and big A at the bottom just like this. Each time I click it, it'll make that bigger or smaller, enabling me to read this article in a distraction-free environment with the font and color scheme that works best for me. Let's click back on the address bar again. In addition to those functions, in many cases, we have the ability to listen to the page. Clicking this button will read everything on that website to us. And if I click this button in the lower left-hand corner, I can find any text within this page. Clicking here can allow me to search the entire site for something like AI. By using the arrows on the right side, I can move from one selection to the next all the way through the document. making it simple for me to find anything on that web page. But there's even more features hidden on the address bar. Let's click it one last time here, and in the bottom right corner where we see the three dots, let's click on that, and there's a ton of new features, including the ability to print out this page, add a bookmark to it, request a desktop website, or even control privacy settings like camera, microphone, and location capability for this website. All of that right from the address bar. No wonder they put it down at the bottom. But there's still one more trick that the address bar has to offer, and believe me, it's a doozy. If we click on the tab button in the lower right-hand corner, we'll see that there are a ton of tabs that are currently open. I can use this screen to quickly jump to any one of those tabs. Clicking on the tab button again, I can even find the next tab. But if you use the address bar, you can browse through those tabs by swiping left or right on the bar like this. As I go to the left, it shows each of the next tabs that is currently open, until I get to the point where I'm at the final tab, or what's known as the top tab. Looking to the right of our address bar, we can see another tab peeking out on the right side here. Let's do one last swipe to the left like this, and notice there's no more tabs. That's because we're currently on the last tab that's open. But here's where we get to use my favorite address bar tip of all, creating a new tab. If we swipe from the right to the left, we'll actually open up a brand new tab, but not any tab. We'll open up what's called your start page. And your start page is a customizable page that offers all sorts of amazing tools and ability for you to get right into specific websites or other information. Let's take a look. Up at the top, we've got my favorite websites. These are websites that I've bookmarked and organized into separate categories. And right here, we get this awesome section called iCloud Tabs. iCloud Tabs allows you to open any tab that's on any of your other Apple devices. So if I click Show All, you'll see that these are open on my computer. Clicking on any one of them will open it up on my phone. This means that I can leave websites open on my computer or my iPad and access them instantaneously from my phone simply by coming over to the start page. Scrolling down a little more, you've got options of things you've put onto your reading list. You've got suggestions, and you've even got recently closed tabs. So if you accidentally close something, this makes it easy for you to get right back to that page without having to start over. Scrolling down even further, we've got a privacy report and then this super helpful edit button. Let's click on the edit button. The edit button lets you customize this start page to your heart's content. For example, if you don't need the suggestions or the recently closed tabs or the privacy report, you can turn those sections off. If you want to make sure your reading list is front and center, you can press and hold the three lines and move it up or down into whatever position you like. And if you don't like the picture that's currently showing up, you can turn off the background image altogether, or you can choose your own picture by clicking the X in the upper left-hand corner and clicking the plus button, which will open up your photos library, allowing you to pick any photo you like to use as the background image for this page. When you're done, click the X button and you'll see your brand new start page front and center. So there's a lot of things that the address bar does, but it's just one piece of the puzzle. Next up, let's talk about tabs. Safari on the iPhone is different than it is on your computer. And part of the reason is because on your computer, you have a page that when you open up your browser, it automatically goes to. Maybe it's Yahoo or Google or some other site that gives you news or other information as soon as you start up Safari. But Safari works very differently on the iPhone because unlike the computer where you can have multiple applications open up on your screen at the same time, on the iPhone, we're in one app at a time. So if I'm working on Safari and all of a sudden I've got to jump out to do something in Notes, or I've got to send somebody a text, or the phone rings, I can get distracted and lose my place on that Safari web page. If Safari had a start page that opened up every time you opened Safari, you'd constantly be starting from scratch every single time you left the app. Just think about how frustrated people are on their computer when they're forced to restart and quit their browser. They're concerned about losing all of their tabs and having to start over, but that's never going to happen on Safari. Anytime you want, you can quit Safari, and as soon as you come back, it's going to drop you right back where you left off. Safari on the iPhone is made for you to leave the app and come back without having to start over, and it does this by gathering tabs on top of each other whenever you open a new website. In fact, if you get sent a link via text or email and you click on it on your phone, it will automatically open that link on top of the other tabs that you've already got open. But by clicking this tab button, you can quickly get back to whatever you were working on without having to start from scratch. Tabs are critical on the iPhone, but they're also a lot of clutter. Because you keep opening more and more and more tabs, most people never think to clear them out, and you end up with a laundry list of all sorts of tabs dating back to the beginning of your iPhone, possibly even years and years. It's easy to close a tab by clicking the X button in the upper right-hand corner of the window right here. But that's not the only way you can close a tab. You can also close a tab by swiping it to the left off the screen like this. This is one of the fastest ways to clean up your tabs. But there's even a faster way than that. If you want to clear all of your tabs off at one time, press and hold on the tab button and select where it says close all. You can even set Safari to automatically close tabs for you. Let me show you what I mean. Let's swipe out of Safari, back into settings. You'll see this section where it says close tabs. It can be set to manually 1 day, 1 week, or 1 month. So why do people leave so many tabs open on Safari in the first place? Well, it's usually because they don't know where else to put those websites. They don't want to lose them and they don't want to forget about them. On the computer, we use bookmarks. On the phone, people don't use them as much. They just leave them open, but unfortunately, that's the way things get lost, cluttered, and overwhelmed. It's easy to bookmark any website by going to the website, clicking the share button down at the bottom, and choosing add bookmark. Bookmarks are super valuable even on the phone, but I find that people overuse bookmarks and they bookmark everything and then you end up with this laundry list of hundreds of websites that you're never gonna go back through. If you just keep accumulating more and more and more bookmarks, you're defeating the purpose of being organized and you're never gonna find that site quickly. There's a better way to do it and it's called tab groups. Tab groups is the act of taking tabs that you have open and moving them into separate sections where you can save them for later. Let me show you what I mean. If I click on this icon in the middle right here, you'll see some of my tab groups that include WIP, which is my work in progress tab group. Whenever I've got to leave my computer and I've got incomplete websites, I'll move them into this particular tab group so that I can find them easily. I've even got tab groups for researching things like AI or business information or Mac or YouTube information. By using tab groups, I can take open tabs and put them away rather than dumping them into an ever-growing list of bookmarks that I don't want to look at. Let me show you how you do it. Right from this page, if you press and hold on any open tab, you will get the option to move that tab. Clicking here will allow you to move it into any of the tab groups that you've got or to create a new tab group by clicking down at the bottom. This belongs in my shirts tab group, so let's click on it and it will move it out of my main window and into the shirts group. Let's go take a look. Click on this icon down in the middle again and open up my shirts view. From here, you can see some of the shirts that I found on different websites online that I'd like to purchase. If I swipe to the right on this bar here, I can go into my tech tab group where you can see some of the products I'd like to purchase for my technology work. And if we swipe in the other direction, we can find some of the AI websites that I've been researching. By using tab groups, you can easily organize separate groups of websites so that when you have the time to purchase a new shirt, you know exactly where to go to find the shirts that you want. And once you've purchased that shirt, you can remove it from your tab group by swiping it off the screen to the left like that. This makes it easy for me to find what I'm looking for, whether it's shirts that I'd like to purchase or technology products, or really anything else. Tab groups is one of my favorite Safari tools and it's so easy to use. There's another way that you can add any website into a tab group right from the website itself. In this case, we've got an article about AI. That should go in my AI research tab group. So I'm going to press and hold on the address book here and click move to tab group, point to the AI tab group, and poof, it's moved over and I don't have to worry about ever losing it. And tab groups synchronize across all of your devices, your iPad, your phone, and your computer, making sure that you've got access to those tabs wherever you are. Now let's talk about bookmarks, the reader list, and your history. If you click on the little book icon down at the bottom of Safari, you're gonna open up your bookmarks list. Across the top, you'll see three separate tabs. Bookmarks show up right here. This is an easy way to find and organize websites that you go back to on a regular basis. By going into your favorites section here, you can create folders or categories to organize all the bookmarks you've got. Pressing the edit button in the lower right-hand corner here will allow you to move things around by pressing and holding on the bars on the right side, or allow you to create a new folder. A folder is a great way to organize bookmarks. For example, there's a ton of courses that I've purchased that I need to go back and reference time and time again. I can do it easily by putting all of the courses together into a course folder, and then here they are, allowing me to quickly get into any of these trainings without hunting around or trying to remember what the website is. It's easy to create any folder from the edit button and then clicking the new folder button. To the right of the bookmark bar, we've got our reading list. By clicking here, you can easily save and organize any articles that you've read or would like to read. And when you add an article to the reading list, it automatically saves it for offline reading. So even if you're on an airplane, you can still read that article. Let me show you what I mean. If I'm on this article and I'd like to read it, but I can't read it right now, I can press the share button at the bottom middle. And from here, I can scroll down and I can add that article to my reading list. Now, whenever I want to, I can click on the bookmark icon and it's right there, ready for me to read whenever I've got the time. To the right of the reading list, we've got our history. This shows you every website you've gone onto on Safari dating back as long as you save your history. You can find websites that you opened but forgot about. So even if you accidentally closed that tab or didn't bookmark that particular web page, by coming into the history, you can find the websites you were on recently or even weeks or months ago. So the bookmark list, the reading list, and the history list give you amazing functionality to access your favorite sites, to save articles you want to read, or keeping track of what websites you've been on recently or even way in the past. Now let's talk about the share button. Sharing from Safari is awesome, and it's easy to do by clicking this share button right here. That share button will open up a host of tools. Down here, you can share to all sorts of apps. Maybe I'd like to share this website via text or email with a friend of mine. Or maybe I'd like to take this website and add a reference to it in Notes so I could find it easily and quickly. Or my favorite tool is to take a website and add it to reminders. This means I can be alerted at a specific day, time, or place to go back to that website, which can be extremely helpful when you want to purchase something, but you don't want to purchase it yet. If I come over to this website where I've got this awesome shirt that I'd like to buy, I can press the share button and I can select the reminders option right here. This will alert me at whatever day or time I want. By coming into my details section, I can put it into a specific list like my to purchase list. And then I can make sure that it reminds me tomorrow when I have time to buy it. And it will automatically alert me on all my devices with a link to this web page. The share button is super functional, but in addition to using it to share to all sorts of apps, you can also use it to add a bookmark, to find something on a web page, or even print that website. There's a ton of amazing tools hidden right in that share section here. Pretty amazing stuff, right? Now, in just a moment, I'm gonna drop my MacWhisperer power tip, which is gonna give you the capability to instantly access a website without having to go to your bookmarks or anything. But before I do, if you got great value and learned something new, give this video a thumbs up to help other people find it. And if you got a question, a comment, you just wanna say, "Hi, Dylan, I like your shirt," drop it down in the comments section. And if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, I got bad news for you. Tim Cook just called and he said, if you don't subscribe immediately, your left AirPod will keep falling out of your ear perpetually. We don't want that to happen. So hit that subscribe button and that notify bell so you're always alerted whenever I drop new content. And now, let's get into the power tip. One of the most frustrating things about mobile Safari is one of its greatest strengths. The fact that it always brings you back to where you left off is awesome, except when you need to get to something quickly. Sure, we can come down into our bookmark section and hunt for that page that we need to get to, or we can leave it in the tab groups and immediately go over and find that tab group when we need to, but that's just too many steps for me. If there is a website that you need to get to regularly, there is an easy way for you to do it. First, go to that website. Once you're there, click the share button and scroll down until you see where it says add to home screen. This will allow you to create an app-like link directly on your homepage, pointing you right to that website. So whether it's a course that you want to get back to or a website that you use for tracking your time and you're in it all the time, by clicking add to home screen, You can give it a name and click the Add button, and that will show up right on your home screen. So whenever you need to get to that web page, all you have to do is click that one button and it will take you right there. So we learned a ton today, but there's always more to learn. Click this video right here if you'd like to learn even more about how to use your Apple products to supercharge your productivity and your life. I'm Dylan Stewart. I'll see you in the comments.